He's going to run straight ahead, but a guy hit him. Shockley down, and he's not up yet.
1 week ago, the Georgia Bulldog Nation let out a collective gasp when quarterback DJ Shockley was felled by injury. With rough seas ahead, Georgia turns to a third-generation Bulldog, Joe Tereshinski, to captain the ship. If he can steer them free of trouble, an undefeated season, SEC championship, and a chance to play for the national title loom just over the horizon. Trying to weather their own storm are Urban Meyer's Florida Gators. Navigating the uncharted waters of the SEC for the first time, Meyer and his crew are about to experience firsthand the fury that is the Georgia-Florida rivalry.
One, Lindsey, 25, 20, 50, 10, 5, Lindsey Scott.
For nearly a century, Georgia-Florida, making history one play at a time. Now is the time for this generation of Dogs and Gators to come ashore and claim their place in this rivalry's lore. We welcome you to the Home Depot SEC on CBS. Pre-game festivities began in earnest last night and lasted throughout the evening. They continue this afternoon hard by the banks of the St. John's River in downtown Jacksonville, Florida. The Gators and the Bulldogs meeting in a very significant SEC Eastern Division encounter this afternoon. Georgia undefeated 7-0. Florida Gators twice beaten. They come in 5-2. Good afternoon, everybody. Vern Lundquist along with Todd Blackledge and Tracy Wolfson. 73rd time these two teams have met in Jacksonville. This one quite significant. Take a look at the Eastern Conference standings, where Georgia is alone at the top. If they win today, they can clinch the division before the leaves finish falling and the clocks are turned back. Florida, with a victory today, maintains hope. They will need help. Someone else has to beat Georgia, but they do have their postseason aspirations still fervent. And this afternoon, the starting quarterback for the Georgia Bulldogs, a 22-year-old junior, Joe Tereshinski III. He is replacing the injured DJ Shockley. You are entitled to ask, just who is this man?
Who is Georgia's quarterback?
Joe Tereshinski.
Joe T, baby! Joe T gonna walk the dog!
JT, TJ, something like that.
T, dog. Tereshinski.
Spell Tereshinski.
You spell it.
L-O-S-E-R.
I cannot spell that.
T-E-R-E.
T-E-R-E-S-K-I-N-I.
Any doubt that it's called the world's largest outdoor cocktail party? Well, your take. Who is Joe Tereshinski?
Well, he's a third-generation Bulldog following the steps of his dad and granddad. He's 4 years in the program. He's a coach's kid. And really, up until last week, the only chance he's had of getting on the field has been as a special teams player. Last year, he served as a long snapper in a couple ball games. More recently, he's the personal protector and he's on the hands team. But no more special teams for Joe T, because now he's the starting quarterback for the Georgia Bulldogs. When he came in for DJ Shockley in the second quarter, he played okay. 5 of 9, 91 yards, secured the 23-20 victory. Now he's had a whole week of practice under his belt, and his primary job, don't try to win the game, manage the game, get the ball in the hands of the right people, and he gets to do it in a game that he dreamed about playing in from the time he was a little kid, the Florida-Georgia game.
Well, Todd, he is the unknown quantity in this game. The Florida quarterback, a very well-known quarterback, Chris Leak, and he is really struggling.
Well, if Joe Tereshinski's living a dream, Chris Leak's trying to end a nightmare today. After a great start the first four games, he struggled the last three games, hit rock bottom 2 weeks ago in Baton Rouge, but it hasn't been all Chris Leak. This whole offense has had problems with execution. I think today they'll do a lot to make him more comfortable in the pocket.
Florida Gators, they are the home team in this 73rd Jacksonville encounter between these two squads. Arm in arm, they started this at Tennessee. They come rank and file. The Bulldogs of Georgia. Unbeaten Dogs, twice beaten Gators. We'll be back with a kick in a moment. Well, it's a picture-perfect day, but gusty winds, 67 degrees. Todd, you were down in the field. The winds will have an effect.
Yeah, they will have an effect. They'll have an effect on the quarterbacks throwing it, the kickers, the return guys. It's a little breezier than you might expect.
Bulldogs claim a 46th victory in a game that was played in 1904. Georgia said not true. Florida, rather. We didn't start our football team until 1906. There is a game that was played that is in dispute. And so the records reflect one less game in the Florida annals.
You know, I think this game will be a low-scoring game decided in the fourth quarter, but I think the first quarter will be very critical for both teams and both quarterbacks in particular. Getting off to a good start is critical for both guys.
Brandon Coutu will kick. Manson and Gavin and Dickey are the deep men. And this one is going to sail way deep in the end zone all the way through. And it will come out to the 20-yard line. And it means we will see Chris Leak struggling in his first year in Urban Meyer's offense.
But I'm really interested to see what they do with Chris today, because they've had the extra week of practice. And I think they're going to do some things to make him more comfortable, because they don't have a chance in this game today if Chris Leak is not comfortable and confident. And we'll find out very early on how he looks. If he puts his foot in the ground and steps and throws, that's a good sign for Florida.
Deshaun Wynn and Keaston Moore both in the backfield as protectors. Chad Jackson in motion. Here's the handoff coming left to Deshaun Wynn. And the contact made at the 23. The tackle finally brought down at the 27. Here are the Gator lineups brought to you by BP. Randy Hand, Tavares Washington, Mike DeGore, his 46th consecutive start, Ristler and Butler. Deshaun Wynn in the backfield. Baker, Cornelius, and Jackson, the wideouts. And Tate Casey, the tight end. Urban Meyer, first full season, 41-year-old head coach, came here from Utah. And it's second down and three. Three wides to the right. Now one is in motion. That's Dallas Baker. Leak to throw on second down. Deep. He's got a man wide open. It's Casey, and Leak overthrew it.
Yep. They have not had the tight end involved in their offense too much. This time they have him in. They go to him as the primary read, and he was open on the corner route right on the Florida sideline. Just a slight overthrow by Chris Leak. Again, a lot of adrenaline early in the game for Chris Leak, and just a little bit too much on that throw.
Third and three.
This is where I want to see what they do. Third down. When they played LSU 2 weeks ago, every time they got into an empty set backfield, LSU blitzed them. Right away, the first time they've got a back in the backfield with Chris. So that means six potential blockers.
Georgia with three men down, six on the line. This is Wynn in motion. And Leak goes across the middle, has the first down. The catch is made by Dallas Baker at the 32-yard line. Defensively for this Georgia Bulldog team, Will Thompson, Ray Gant, Gerald Anderson, and Quentin Moses. Kedrick Golston is not in uniform, injured. Verdun Wheeler, Tony Taylor, and Jarvis Jackson are the linebackers. Minter Blue, the hard-hitting Greg Blue, Trey Battle, and Tim Jennings. Billy Latsko is in now, number 42. He's a blocking back to the right side, and this is Cornelius in motion. They'll hand it off straight up the middle. Big hole. And Verdun Wheeler is up around the shoulders to make the tackle, but that is a huge gain of 13 yards.
And a different type of formation. This was not a spread offense formation. They've got a tight end, they've got a blocking back, and they're giving it to the fullback. They've got extra blockers. This is a power running set. They also brought the wide receiver in motion to block, Chad Jackson. Power football with a power back, Deshaun Wynn. Tavares Washington, the guard, leading up through there. And a couple good runs early for Florida.
Gain of 13, play action. Oh, they hand it off to Wynn. Wynn heads left, cuts back right, and picks up a nice gain of five out to the 48-yard line.
Hand off to 21, Wynn.
Well, you might have noticed, hard not to. New unis for the Florida Gators. Can you spell marketing opportunity? The intent, of course, is to attract your attention and sell a few in stores throughout the country, and I'm sure it's a little weird looking. That's the point.
Well, Virginia Tech with the same thing on Thursday night.
And Miami had new uniforms today, too. Here's Leak being chased by Will Thompson. That pass incomplete across the 50 at the 47-yard line, intended for Tate Casey.
Tim Jennings with the coverage.
And this Florida, Deshaun Wynn has earned his spot now at the starter, but they have really struggled on the ground against the best opponents they've played.
And that's, you know, it's not just the offensive line. It's a little bit of everybody involved in that. It's Chris Leak making the right reads in the running game. But when this offense is working, it starts with having a good, solid zone running game. And if you don't have that, it really limits what you can do.
Take Casey in on 3rd and 6. And again, they do not go with the empty backfield. That's where LSU killed them 2 weeks ago. Leak has a man at the 40. Dallas Baker, second catch, first down, second, third down conversion.
Okay, now if you're Urban Meyer and Dan Mullen, you are very excited in what you're seeing from Chris Leak right now, because watch him set his feet. This is not what he did 2 weeks ago in Baton Rouge. Good protection. He steps up in the pocket. He makes a strong throw to the sideline because his feet were set. He wasn't backing up. He wasn't falling backwards. And Chris Leak looks confident, and he looks comfortable so far early in the game.
Redshirt freshman Marcus Manson is in the backfield now. That's Kenneth Tukes in, and there's the option. And the handoff to Manson. Speedster from Tuscaloosa, Alabama. Let's take another look at Chris Leak, Don.
For any quarterback, it is so critical to be on balance. And throwing accurately is more to do with your feet than it is with your arm. Get your feet set, get your weight transferred, step into the throw, and throw with accuracy. And Chris Leak is off to a good start.
First 7 games, only 33 yards of total offense on their first possession, already 42 in this. It's 2nd down and 8.
And a lot of Billy Latsko, a lot of Tate Casey, more power formations.
Here's the flip out to Manson, and he's at the 35-yard line. Thinking back to our conversation, Meyer on the phone on Wednesday, and you asked him, what changes, what tweaking of the offense do you have in mind?
Well, they've got to get the ball to the perimeter. They've got to threaten the defense everywhere. Chris Leak is so far has not been able to do that in running the option. So I asked Urban, how are you going to threaten the perimeter? He says, well, it's a big part of our plan. I'd rather not discuss it right now. Well, that kind of play right there is that. Swing the back out, get him the ball outside, see if he can make somebody miss, and threaten the whole defense all the way across the field.
10th play of the drive, the opening drive of this ball game. Tukes is wide to the right. Leak has it, flips it out to Sean Wynn all by himself. And Wynn, first down at the 26. I'm also thinking of in their games against Tennessee, LSU, and Alabama. Two of those losses they've had in those 3 games, 1 sustained touchdown drive.
That's right. And you can see the effects of an off week right now with Florida. They look confident. Chris Leak looks comfortable in the pocket. They've had some good running success early in the game, and Deshaun Wynn looks like he's come to play as well. And when that big guy gets going, he is a tough guy to bring down out in the open field.
And again, Billy Latsko is on the field. That's him, number 42. Lead blocker. Here's a play fake. Leak goes deep for Cornelius in the end zone. And there's a flag. 2 flags. Tim Jennings defending. I think he defended a little too aggressively.
Well, Tim Jennings knew he was beat. I mean, he had no chance other than to foul, or else it's a touchdown for Florida. Jennings is beat right there. See, he's in a trail position. Chris Leak puts the ball out there, and Tim Jennings has no choice but to interfere to prevent a touchdown.
Pass interference, number 23 on the defense. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
And this is where the college rule is not as deadly for a defense as the pro rule. Pro rule, that ball's on the 1-yard line for Florida. In this case, it's just outside the 10.
Mark Richt in his 5th year, outstanding record at Georgia. Team is 49-10 under Mark Richt, and that was after a first year of 8-4. They've only allowed one team to score in the opening drive. That was Mississippi State, a field goal. Draw play. Wynn dances right, and he's down at the 11.
And I will say this. I mentioned I'm interested to see what Florida does differently to protect Chris Leak to make him more comfortable. And they have played Billy Latsko in this series five times, which is more than we've probably seen him all season on the offensive side of the ball, other than short yardage and goal line. They have him in, they have Tate Casey in, a lot more tighter formations mixing in with the spread option look.
Billy Latsko, who was the starting fullback a year ago, went to linebacker and then early in this season back into the offense. He's on the bench right now, second down and nine. Florida has not been that effective inside the 20 this season. Here's the handoff to the end. They are this time.
Wow, look,
nice tackle by Greg Blue.
When he hits you, you go backwards, even if you're a 235-pound running back. I mean, that is an impressive tackle by a safety. This looked for sure like Deshaun Wynn was going to score. He had full momentum, and Greg Blue hits him, and immediately he goes backwards the other way.
Looks like bumper cars.
That's 215 hitting 230 and 215 one.
Third and inches, scoreless first quarter. Well, we mentioned Florida's offensive problems. Georgia has not been that adept defending inside the 20. Latsko in motion, now back to the right. Play fake, leak. He'll tuck it and run. Touchdown. Great start if you're a Florida fan.
Wow. Great start if you're Chris Leak, too. When you go into a bye week after a loss, it is difficult. It takes a few days to get that sour taste out of your mouth. But Chris Leak is off to an excellent start.
Extra point from Hetland. He is up and good. 80-yard drive. First team to score a touchdown against Georgia on the opening drive this season. And it came on the feet of Chris Lee. Gators lead 7-0. I'm thinking back to that long fourth quarter drive we saw in this Florida-Tennessee game. That Chris Leak led it, secured the victory over Tennessee. This is the best drive they've had since that one.
Yeah. I mean, you know, he played well in the Kentucky game, but you've got to kind of throw that one out because against the better competition, you're right, that's the best one.
This is Tyson Browning, number 31, and he is driven down at the 21-yard line. Joe Tereshinski, the third, is now going to play as a starter for the first time for Georgia. For more, here's Tracy.
Thanks, guys. As you mentioned earlier, Joe Tereshinski is fully aware of what this Georgia-Florida rivalry is all about. Let's just say he was destined to play in this game. Take a look at this picture that hangs in his bedroom at home. It's of a young Georgia fan clutching a football and dreaming of one day playing quarterback against, of all teams, the Gators. Joe's dad gave him the picture when he was just 8 years old and said to him, maybe one day you'll play in this game.
And he is doing so right now. Play fake, goes deep. He's got his tight end who drops the ball. Martrez Milner had 2 yards on the defender, Reggie Nelson. It would have been a huge start.
And how about Mark Richt? Everybody's saying, well, he'll probably be conservative today with the new quarterback. Uh-uh. Martrez Milner's right here. He's going to be the primary receiver after they fake the reverse. And you give Joe Tereshinski a chance to make a big throw right away. And Milner, who did not play last week with a shoulder injury, not able to make the catch.
Second down and 10, backs in the eye. Hand off right side, Thomas Brown cuts it up, gets 1 yard. Joe Tereshinski the third, last time he started a game, December 8, 2001, when he was a senior quarterback at Athens Academy, and they lost to Clinch County in the Class A quarterfinals in Georgia high school football. Born and raised in Athens, his dad, Joe Jr., is on the staff, actually on the sideline. His father, grandfather, Joe Sr., watching at his home in Bethesda, Maryland.
Third down and 8. This is where Florida's defense is extremely good.
Blitz, screen pass, right side. Dangerous for Thomas Brown because Jarvis Herring got there about the time the ball got there.
When Florida's defense gets you in third and 7 or more, they have been devastating this year. They bring pressure at the young quarterback. Tereshinski not a clear throwing lane to throw that screen, and Jarvis Herring right there. Even if the ball's caught, it's going to be a loss of yardage play.
That will bring on Gordon Ely Kelso, the junior who likewise is from Athens, on fourth and eight. He's had a very effective year. 16 punts inside the 20, and only 10 have been returned by oppositions this year, by the opposition.
It's been one of the real strengths of this Georgia team is their special teams and how they've played field position.
Burnell Brown is back. This is a good punt. Chases Brown back to the 30-yard line. He's got a little room. Dances out of a tackle. Now he's got a lot of room. And the first special teams play in favor of the Gators.
And this is a team coming into the game 103rd in the nation in punt returns, averaging only 5 yards per punt return before that one. But because it was a low driving kick, Burnell Brown was able to catch it with a lot of space. He made the first guy miss, and then there was no white jerseys close to him because the kick did not have very good hang time. Florida, a huge return, and great field position again.
A 30-yard punt return, longest of the season for Burnell Brown, and Florida opens up its second possession at the 41-yard line. Here's Leak. Play fake. Still has it. Right side. Caught at the 20. Dallas Baker, third catch.
And again, this is the Chris League that Willie Martinez was afraid they might see. The Chris League that made big throws 2 years ago here as a freshman against his team. Dallas Baker isolated on DeMario Minter, a big target and a perfect throw to the sideline. High and outside for a tall receiver, impossible for Minter to defend. But Chris League is setting his feet and throwing like he's capable of throwing.
That's a gain of 21 and a first down at the 20. Up the middle we go, and a broken tackle, Deshaun Wynn, down at the 2. Greg Blue finally makes the stop, but somebody missed him 10 yards further back.
Deshaun Wynn had 93 yards 2 weeks ago against a tough LSU team. Urban Meyer said he's really grown up. He's taken that job now, and he is running like a man who knows he's the man at the tailback position. Great burst and strength busting tackles.
Well, what a start for Florida. Picture perfect. And they've got a first down and goal with a 7-0 lead. Cornelius. They give it off, and a nice defensive charge at the line thwarts the effort of Deshaun Wynn. That was Darius Swain, number 98. Mark Richt.
You are really hoping, if you're Mark Richt and his staff right now, that you can hold Florida to a field goal attempt here, because you don't want to put any more pressure on Joe Tereshinski than you have to. I mean, it's already enough pressure, his first start playing in this game, but to go 2 touchdowns down midway through the first quarter, that's a lot to ask of a young quarterback.
Latsko and Wynn, along with Tate Casey. And this is Billy Latsko, number 42. Play fake. Leak, deep. Casey, touchdown. That is Tate Casey's first touchdown of this season. He had 4 a year ago. And Chris Leak may be emerging from the nightmare that has been the last 3 weeks. Extra point by Chris Hetland is up and through.
Well, this is a similar play to the one Chris Leak ran in. It's two guys. Tate Casey is going to the back of the end zone. Right here, we're going to the front corner of the end zone. So you kind of get a high-low on the defense. Latsko comes out to the front. Tate Casey in the back of the end zone. And this time, Chris Leak says, I've got enough room to stick it in there for the throw. And 2 touchdowns early for the Florida Gator offense.
6:09 to go in the first. It's already 14-0 Florida. All right, thank you, Tim. On the left, Joe Tereshinski in his dreams last night. I don't think he envisioned being down 14-0 when he was going to get his fourth snap. On the right, the nightmare you alluded to may be ending.
Yeah, absolutely. And this is a great start for Chris Leak. And you got to feel good for the guy because he was a great quarterback last year. He's had some struggles this year, but super start so far.
Jonathan Phillips kicks it off. taken by Tyson Browning. And he spilled at the 25-yard line. So Joe Tereshinski, the third, comes on for the second set in the game. Let's take a look at the offense that surrounds Joe Tereshinski. Up front, Inman, his roommate, Nick Jones, Tanner, Gene Gillis, and Dennis Rowland. Thomas Brown in the backfield, the fullback Sutherland, Sean Bailey, Brian McClendon, the wideouts, and Leonard Pope is a load at tight end.
And I think Tereshinski needs to find his tight ends, and they need to throw well on early downs against this defense.
They keep this one on the ground and lose a couple of yards. Defensively for Florida, there's Ray McDonald. Injured a knee against Tennessee. He's out there right now. Cohen, Thomas, Harris, and Mincy, the starters. McCullough, Siler, Everett, the linebackers. And a change in the secondary where Reggie Nelson is opening at strong safety. He replaces Kyle Jackson.
Ray McDonald and Joe Cohen are going to alternate series, try to keep them both fresh in the game.
There's a running play up the middle. Danny Ware, number 28, gets a bunch back. It'll leave Georgia facing a third down and approximately four. DJ Shockley injured a knee last week in the win over Arkansas. He is expected back. They've got a bye week after this week, and then they're at home against Auburn. And DJ Shockley, you talked to him before the game. He's hurting.
He said it was just killing him not to play. He's feeling pretty good physically.
Right. And they have a trailing wind in this quarter. That advantage will end shortly. That's going to be close, but it appears it's enough to move the chain as Sutherland gets a rare carry. That's only his 10th of the year.
We talk about keys for Georgia. Number one, they've got to avoid third and seven plus. That was third and one, and they converted. Secondly, Joe T's got to look for those tight ends. He's going to have to make some throws against man coverage. The tight ends are the best mashups. And then defensively, they have to find ways to pressure Chris Leak. They have not done that in the first quarter so far when Florida's had the ball.
That's the end of the first quarter. The Florida Gators leading 14 to nothing. We'll return to Jacksonville after this message and this word from your local station. We begin the second quarter, and the Dogs trail the Gators 14 to nothing in Jacksonville. First down and 10, Joe Tereshinski, the third. Hand off, they'll sweep it to the left side. Nice play by this defensive unit, Jeremy Mincy, and there's Brandon Siler. I would think, Todd, a very important series now offensively for the Bulldogs.
Yeah, they got a couple first downs, so they got a little bit of momentum. They've withstood this initial flurry in the first quarter by Florida, but I think they've got to do some things. We talked about making Chris Leak comfortable. They've got to make Joe Tereshinski comfortable, and the way they can do that, run the football with some success, throw on early downs with play action, and look to work the ball to those tight ends. That's their best matchups, I think, on the field.
No gain on the last play, second down and 10. Here's Sutherland leading the play around the right side. Brunell Brown missed the tackle, and Thomas Brown moves out near the 47-yard line.
Again, you see the strength of Thomas Brown, and that play looked like it might be a 1 or 2 yard gain, but his ability to shake off an arm tackle and get it up closer to the sticks makes another manageable third down situation.
Third and three, Thomas Brown, 7 carries so far. Georgia has kept it conservative. Joe Tereshinski, 22 years of age, born and raised in Athens, first start ever. Tereshinski, he's got it into the secondary. How about that?
And I'll guarantee you Florida was not expecting that with DJ Shockley in street clothes on the sideline. With Shockley in the offense, you've got to be concerned about quarterback runs. Excellent call by Mark Rick. But again, it's third down and short, so they can run the ball. And Tereshinski shows he's a little better runner than people might think. A little more athletic at that quarterback position. Really caught the Florida defense unaware. And a nice conversion. Thomas Brown did a nice job of lead blocking on that play for his quarterback.
There's his dad, Joe Tereshinski Jr.
Yeah, so he says during the offense, he watches the offensive line. I got to believe he's peeking at his son.
That would look like it might have been tipped. 14-0 here as well.
This is a big play right here. Second down and 10. They can't afford to be third and 10. They've only thrown it once.
Here's Tereshinski back, under some trouble, wings it, caught it! Oh boy, off his back foot! And he finds Leonard Pope, the tight end.
See, the reason you've got to use these tight ends is because they're extremely talented players, Pope and Milner. They're both big, so that's big targets. That means a bigger margin of air on a throw. Tereshinski flushed out of the pocket off his back foot, wings it outside, and he knows he's got this big guy with the huge wingspan at 6'7 to snag the football. But they're hard to match up with a safety or linebacker because they're big and they're fast.
Pope had two touchdowns in the win last year, a 31-24 victory. And here's the handoff to Thomas Brown. They try to sweep to the right, pick up maybe a yard. This sequence has gone rhythmically, and Florida has owned Georgia the last 15 years. 13 of 15 wins.
Gain of two, second and eight.
This is the 13th play of this Georgia drive. They're down by two touchdowns, third and seven. Play fake, Tereshinski, good coverage in the end zone, and it was almost intercepted by D. Webb. It'll be fourth down.
Now, D. Webb is the top cover guy for this Gator defense. He's on Massaqua, who is just a true freshman, and he is right in his hip pocket. See how quickly D. got his head around and his eyes? He knew exactly when the ball was coming. If he doesn't get his eyes around quickly, maybe that ball sneaks in past him, but he got his head around so quick that he made a great play on the football.
Brandon Cattu for the field goal. He's 16 of 19 for the year. This from 31 yards out. Tricky breeze, but he knocks it through. So Georgia gets on the board, their first impressive offensive set of this ball game. Cattu from 31.
Pretty conservative play on third down. Fake play action. Go against their best corner. Incomplete, but they did get 3 points out of it. Florida here in the second quarter. What's it like being a true freshman wide receiver playing in the SEC? Well, this is a little wake-up call from the new free safety for Florida, Reggie Nelson. And you wonder, why is Nelson playing free safety as Massaqua gets worked on? He is an impact player. Four sacks on the season. He only played 28 out of the 71 defensive snaps against LSU 2 weeks ago, and he's too good of a player to not have on the field all the time. So they moved him in at free safety. He played safety last year at Coffeyville, so it's not that unusual for him to be in there, and he is a dynamic player.
14-play drive gets Georgia on the board. Here's Cattu with the kick, and it's taken by Marcus Manson. Comes right. Struggles for the last 5 yards and is tackled by Trey Battle. First and 10 with a 14-3 lead, 3:08 to go. Here's the big hole. Win. All the way inside the 45, chased by Greg Blue. 21 picks up. 21.
Boy, this is by far the best Florida has run the football against a quality defense. This offensive line has taken a lot of heat, but they're kind of settled down now. Look at that. Look at that lane right there for Deshaun Witt. Excellent blocking by Randy Hand. Tavares Washington, the right guard. A huge crease in the Georgia defense. They feel like they've settled the guard position. They were set at tackle. The guards is where they were having some problems, but Washington and Ristler now have settled in at the two guards.
And Jim Tart, who started a couple, is out of this game with an injury. Here's the handoff to Deshaun Wynn, number 21. Tart is on the sidelines in civvies. I miss him because I wanted to say his hometown, yeah, which is
Slop Choppy.
Slop Choppy, Florida. Mm-hmm. Always enjoy your dissertation on the benefits of living in Slop Choppy. Second and six.
Well, this running game has not been sloppy for Florida today. Coming into the game, they'd averaged only 3.9 yards per carry. There you see 109 yards, the rush defense for Georgia. Florida already passed that, averaging nearly 7 yards a carry.
Marcus Manson back on the field. Tate Casey, here's Leak, back to throw. Blitz from the linebacker. The catch made at the 25-yard line by Tate Casey. 15-yard gain.
Tate Casey only had 3 catches coming into today, right? 2 of them already in the ball game. And you can see the change, the formation and personnel changes. Tight ends, that's Casey in motion. He's going to go out to the sideline. Again, Leak not under pressure, able to set his feet and throw with accuracy. When he's comfortable and he's confident, as he is today, he doesn't miss many passes.
Demario Mitter injured on the tackle. He's given way to Paul Oliver now. Number 8 is on the field. And here's the handoff to Manson. Goes left. This time, nothing doing. Will Thompson, number 58. And again, protectors on either side of Chris Leak. He steps up, has time, goes deep. It's caught. That's Chad Jackson, first and goal, Florida.
And it all is because of the protection. It started with two backs in the backfield, which says, okay, if they bring people, we're going to have seven guys to block. If they don't bring pressure, we'll release the backs out into the route, and it's up to the front five. And they did their job. It's a four-man rush, so the backs go out. Chris Leak smartly steps up in the pocket and still has his feet set to make the throw. And again, when he sets his feet, he doesn't miss very often.
First and goal, Florida, with a 14-3 lead. Fumble! There is a scramble, and Georgia, I believe, has recovered. Yes!
What a huge play for the Bulldog defense. If they go down 21-3 at half, it's very, very difficult. This looked like a poor exchange between Leak and Wynn. He never had the football, went right through his arms, and Georgia able to come up with the football. A poor exchange. What a costly turnover. They've only fumbled the ball three times all season. That one, very costly.
Tony Taylor pounced on it. Halftime with our score 14-3. Ready for a conversation with Mark Richt, and it's presented by Charles Schwab. Here's Tracy.
Coach, how big was that turnover in terms of momentum going into the second half?
Oh, we needed it. I mean, we're in trouble. It could have been 21-3 right now. 14-3 is something we could battle back. I mean, we would hope that we could battle back from 21, but it had made it a lot tougher on us.
What do you think of Joe T's performance so far?
And not bad, not bad. He actually needs a little help from his friends catching the ball a little bit, but I think he's done a nice job.
Thanks a lot. Good luck.
Well, that's the end of the first half with our score 14-3. Now let's go to Tim Brando in our New York studio. A little more of a party atmosphere if you're wearing orange and blue, I would think, as we get set for the start of the third quarter. 14-3, Florida. Georgia will get the ball. They won the toss to begin the game, deferred the option. Before 80,000 at Alltel Stadium in Jacksonville, Vern Lundquist, Todd Blackledge, Tracy Wolfson. And these two teams meeting here, Joe Tereshinski, 3 of 11, another hand pat from DJ Shockley. And Jonathan Phillips will kick off.
Joe T's numbers not impressive in the first half, 3 of 11, 41 yards, but I don't think he played poorly either. Had that one ball that got away from him, had a couple passes that should have been caught. The first pass he threw to Martrez Milner should have been caught for a big play. The throw to McClendon on the slant against man-to-man should have been caught. So he's got a whole half of football here. And again, that turnover right before the half to keep it at 14-3 was enormous for Georgia.
Tyson Browning and Thomas Brown are the deep men. Jonathan Phillips will kick off for the Florida Gators.
Tyson Browning had a 52-yard return last week in the win over Arkansas.
Browning goes into the end zone. He'll bring it out from 2 yards in, and he's got some room. Flag is down. This one will go in the direction of the St. John's River.
And once again, now Georgia will start with poor field position. Their last four possessions of the first half started on their average 13-yard line, and this one's going to be right back there again.
Give me your definition of a significant offensive possession. This one?
Yeah, although it is important that the offense plays better, but I think the real burden for Georgia is on their defense. I think from the rest of this game, the pressure is on the Georgia defense. They did not stop the run of Florida. Florida ran the ball better than they have all year, and they got no pressure on Chris Leak. So Joe Tereshinski has to do his job, but the Georgia defense has to really step up their job.
And the Georgia offense will get it from deep within the shadows of the goalpost. They began at the 15 after the holding call on the kick return. Tereshinski with a toss to Thomas Brown, Sutherland in front. And he is cut out of bounds up near the 21-yard line. Take a look at the halftime stats presented by Wrangler.
You see that 116 yards rushing in the first half for Florida, and they averaged over 5 yards a carry. So because Georgia couldn't stop the run, they couldn't one-dimensionalize Florida, and they couldn't get any pressure on Chris Leak. Not only no sacks, but no hits. They never even knocked him on the ground in the first half. They let him dance and pirouette and do all that stuff in the first half with no pressure.
A couple of pirouettes.
Mm-hmm.
Second and four. Backs in the eye. This would be a give to Thomas Brown, and he is cut down by Jeremy Mincy at the point of the handoff. It'll be third down.
Said this the last time we covered Florida. Jeremy Mincy is a defensive end, and he leads this team in tackles. And that is so unusual for a defensive end to lead the team in tackles, because plays where they run away from him, he's usually not going to be the first guy to get there. But he leads the team from a defensive end position.
Third and three. Out of the shotgun, Tereshinski. Four-man rush, quarterback draw. Tereshinski plunges across the 25 and picks up the first down.
Like the call, we've seen that twice. And again, it all starts with having a manageable yardage needed on third down. And then watch Thomas Brown again lead blocking. I mean, he is a complete back. A super block on Brandon Seiler. That's what got Tereshinski the first down, running the quarterback draw. If it's third and three, third and four, you can run as well as pass for the first down. You get third and seven plus against this team, it's tough.
And there is a flag on the ground. Thomas Ritter will tell us about it.
After the play was over, personal foul, number 57 on the defense, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
That's on Jeremy Mincy.
Yeah, we just talked nice about him for making a tackle, and now a costly penalty on a personal foul gives Georgia excellent position.
You see the reaction of Urban Meyer. And watch for a kick here. A missed kick. Brown breaking a tackle across the 50. Through the 45 and tackled finally by Reggie Nelson, a 17-yard gain.
And I get the sense that our guy Neil Callaway, the offensive coordinator, but more importantly the offensive line coach for Georgia, gave his boys a little talking to in the locker room at halftime. A little renewed vigor for the guys up front. Five seniors. Thomas Brown with the cutback. Check this out right here. Nice block on Jarvis Herring on the backside. Never give up on a play because it could cut back to the other side. Daniel Inman stayed there and got a nice block on Herring to spring it loose.
And Nick Jones, a great block at the point of attack. Here's the toss. They'll come to the near side. D. Webb fights through the block of Sutherland and makes the tackle. Well, Georgia family lost a treasured member of the group last Sunday. Former Georgia football player Don Golden, along with his wife Debbie, killed in a car accident last Sunday. Don was a safety and punter in the early 70s, played on the 71 team that went 11-1. All the Georgia safeties and punters are wearing a number 12 decal on their helmets in memory of Don Golden. Second down and 13. Danny Ware is in. Danny Ware gets a handoff, breaks a tackle down to the 40. It'll be third and nine. Brandon Seiler had the contact behind the line and lost him.
Shows you how important that first down defensive play for Florida was, though. After getting gashed on a couple plays, they come back with a stop behind the line of scrimmage to make it second and 13. Now it's third and 10. So, again, 0-for-4 today when it's third and 7-plus against this Florida defense. When it's inside of 7 yards, they've been pretty successful.
Massaqua, top of the screen. They hand it off, give it to Ware. Ware's loose. Wow. First down at the 25.
Wow, third and 10. They ran right at him, and they made the conversion easily. They ran it to the left side. Check out the blocking over here. Max Gene Gillis, Dennis Rowland, the tight end, Martrez Milner, all of them sticking on their blocks. Leonard Pope. Brandon Sutherland, the fullback. I formation, power running football on third and 10, and they made it easily. That's pretty good execution by Georgia.
Danny Ware, the 6'1 sophomore. On this drive, they've kept it on the ground. They do so again. Tackle made by Earl Everett. Now their current SEC East standings, Georgia with a victory today would clinch a spot in the championship game in Atlanta. If Florida wins, they're still in the chase. They do need someone else to defeat Georgia to have a chance to get to Atlanta. With a victory today, it would be the earliest clinching since they went to divisions in the early 90s. Second down. Second down and five. And again, they keep it. Here's Marcus Thomas.
Woo-hoo. Great play. Oh. Again, Florida is putting extra guys around the line of scrimmage. Eight guys in there. Two tight ends set for Georgia, but Marcus Thomas, with his quickness off the ball, got there behind the line of scrimmage.
Well, that's how a Bulldog urges his team on.
They converted their last third down and long by running it. Now they're in a pass set out of the shotgun on third and seven.
Bailey, McClendon, and Massacor are the three wides. Quarterback draw again, but this time the door closed quickly by Marcus Thomas.
Yeah, Marcus Thomas and Jeremy Mincy both were looking for the quarterback draw that time. They've gotten him a couple times, but this time those guys didn't just bust it up the field. They kind of had their eyes open, and Marcus Thomas and Jeremy Mincy were right there ready to stop it.
So that will bring on Brandon Coutu. Now, above the stadium, the wind is blowing straight into his face. But if you look at the goalpost, it's swirling. And the streamers are going the other direction. From 39 yards out, Coutu. No.
He had made 11 straight before that kick. You talked about the wind, and it's when it swirls, I mean, it does things with kickers' minds. Coutu hit it hard enough, but not accurate enough.
Brandon Coutu, after the missed field goal from 39 yards out, get a sense that he knew it could have been a one-possession game. And let's check in with Tracy.
Guys, good news for Florida. X-rays on wide receiver Dallas Baker's right ankle were negative. He's taped up and riding the bike right now. They say he's going to give it a go.
That is good news. Yeah. Thank you, Tracy.
Hard to catch passes on the stationary bike, though. He's obviously not in this first possession, so that means we're going to see a little bit more of Kenneth Tukes and Billy Latsko, Tate Casey.
Chad Jackson in motion. They hand it off. Come to the right side to Sean Wynn, who had an excellent first half.
And the good news for Georgia, even though they didn't score there, and Coutu obviously very disappointed, is they at least flipped the field. They had been starting inside their own 15 so much. That last possession started on their 15, but because they had some success moving the football, they at least were able to flip the field position a little bit and help their defense out. But this is where the game's going to rest for Georgia. If they want to get back in this game, their defense is going to have to do it for them.
Second down and seven. Chris Leak, 11 of 15 in the first half. Very much in control. Mike DeGore snaps it back. Here's Leak out of the backfield. Wide right, Easton Moore. And a nice job by Demario Minter. That'll bring up third down.
Now, this will be interesting to watch on this third down play, whether Willie Martinez will choose to go after Chris Leak with a blitz. They did not blitz one time in the first half, and Chris Leak never felt any heat. Here's the first third down situation, third and seven. Will Georgia choose to come after him a little bit on this play?
Now they'll go with four down.
And you see two backs in, Latsko and Wynn.
Blitz threatened from the corner. They will not blitz. Leak fires it. Incomplete.
See, that as much as anything is just a little miscommunication between a quarterback who has played a lot and Kenneth Tukes, a wide receiver who has not played a lot. The depth at the wide receiver position has not been a real strength for this Florida team. Tukes in the game, known more as a blocker. This ball thrown in a different spot than where Tukes thought it was going to be.
Move to his right. They're not employing that. Oh, that's a poor one. That one.
Get away from it if you're Georgia.
Absolutely. Out of bounds at the 49-yard line. a 29-yard punt. And it underscores your point about field position. Yeah.
And a costly penalty because field position was already being flipped. They made him kick again. He got a poor kick. And now Joe Tereshinski and the Georgia offense start inside Florida territory.
14-3 with 7 minutes, 43 seconds remaining, third quarter. And this game being played in the swirling winds.
Yeah, it's really hard to tell. I mean, one flag's up top, look like it's blowing one way. Tracy Wolfson just told us it's blowing the other way down on the field. Whichever way it's blowing, Georgia needs to capitalize on this field position, the best they've had by 25 yards in the ball game.
Tyson Browning in motion coming to the near side. There's the reverse. It goes to the right side for A.J. Bryant, who has been injured most of the year. They put that play in specifically for Bryant. And Brandon Seiler might have noticed that, hey, I haven't seen 18 on here. Might pay attention to him. So they try the reverse and they pick up 2.
Nice job by D. Webb also just turning that thing back in. He stayed at home and Seiler was able to make the play coming from inside, but well defended by Florida defense.
Now Tony Milton on at fullback for the first time today, number 9. And Greg Lumpkin is the running back. Tereshinski with pressure, Reggie Nelson. And he batted it up in the air. Reggie Lewis, rather, 22 instead of 32.
Madison and Charlie Strong to bring pressure. He got his hands on the ball, and Tereshinski says, let's regroup and try to hit it on third down.
Third and 8. Inside. Got it. That's very close. I think they got it. Muhammad Massaqua.
And they needed 8, and he caught it at about 3 and had to make up 5 yards on his own. It's going to be very close. It's a little tunnel screen to the wide receiver. He comes a couple steps off, and underneath the lineman released downfield. Ray McDonald from his defensive end position made a great play. But Massaqua did a nice job showing some strength and just continuing to fight forward towards that first down marker.
Short by a smidgen.
I think Georgia needs to go for it here.
Yes.
I mean, they can't. They've got field position, and they really have to capitalize on this field position. It's the best they've had by far.
They've only gone for a first down 4 times on fourth down this year.
I mean, if I go anywhere, I go right behind Big Max Gene Gillis. He's 6'4", 340 pounds, and that might have been in August. We're almost in November. I'll guarantee he's closer to 360 right now. I get right behind Big 74 and just push.
Lumpkin is the deep back in the eye. If it's not, a Tereshinski, they'll give it to the fullback, Sutherland, and he's got a first down.
And they ran, guess where? Behind 74.
Right.
It wasn't the quarterback. It was the fullback. But that's where they went.
He's large.
He is. And he's powerful. They get that pressure in there, that push, that surge, and the big fullback takes it in for the easy first down. Now might be a good time to play action and try to get one deep.
First down at the 39-yard line. Second offensive set in this quarter for the Georgia Bulldogs. They misfired on a 39-yard field goal last time they were here. Here's Tereshinski. Inside pass. It's caught by Sean Bailey, number 4, at the 30-yard line. That'll bring up a second down and 1. It gets high formation. They'll come left side. This is Lumpkin.
Wow, nice run by Lumpkin. He's kind of the forgotten guy in that backfield, you know, with Thomas Brown and Danny Ware. But Lumpkin is a power runner as well, 215-pounder. Missed all of last year with a knee injury. But he gives them another power runner. Nice blocking there by Ryan Schnetzer, the center, number 52. This offensive line for Georgia playing much better here in the second half. Really pushing them.
See what he did 2 years ago. Had 79 yards in that game. Here's Tereshinski with the play fake. That's what you suggested, and there's the pass.
See, it's all single coverage because Florida is going to bring Jarvis Herring, the safety, up to bring him up around the line of scrimmage. So there's one safety, and wherever there's a wide receiver, it's man-to-man coverage. Here's one safety. All these guys are here to stop the run. One-on-one right there. And if you beat the coverage, you've got a lot of open space to throw him the football. And the last two throws by Joe Tereshinski have been his best two throws of the ball game. Right on the dot.
First down at the 12. A 14-3 game. Latter stages, third quarter. Lumpkin and Sutherland still in the eye. Martrez Milner, the tight end. Here is the toss for Lumpkin with Sutherland out in front. But he can't get around the corner because Brian Crum, number 13, the linebacker, got out to make the tackle.
Brian Crum is one of those Georgia guys on this Florida team. You mentioned there were seven players on the Gator team from the state of Georgia. Brian Crum, one of those from Woodbine, Georgia, played at Camden County High School.
The red zone offense for Georgia, not exemplary this year. Urban Meyer looks on. Second down and 7 from the 10. Sean Bailey in motion. Up, oh, Tereshinski slip. Halfback pass. It was designed that way. Tereshinski, that was a fall-down play. And that is a touchdown for the Georgia Bulldogs. He meant to slip. You don't think so?
I don't think so.
You don't think so?
I saw him practice this on Thursday, and he didn't fall on Thursday, partner.
Okay.
Now that might have added to the drama here today. But on Thursday, I'll guarantee he didn't fall down.
Oh, baby.
But what about the poise to get back up and stay with it? I mean, that was a one-shot play right there.
Wow. Well, it added to the drama. How about that?
I think they're going to buzz for a replay on the spot, maybe. Well, we'll see.
All right, so he didn't.
Well, first of all, did he pitch it before he was down? That's the first question. He got stepped on and tripped. As long as he pitched it before a knee was down, the play's okay. Thomas Brown, left-handed throw. Did he get the ball across? Clearly.
Yes, yes.
Clearly got the ball across.
Oh, goodness. The extra point from Katu is up and good. Well, they'll never forget this one.
That's the one he'll tell Joe the fourth. I did try to fall down. I'll show you the film someday. It was a great play. We fooled him, boy.
Tereshinski in the history books. That's dad on the left, son on the right, and grandson on the right, Joe Jr. and Joe the third.
That was something.
Joe Tereshinski, they will talk about that for as long as football is played in Athens. 3:43, 14-10. And the ball's off the tee.
Well, we talked about the burden for Georgia being on their defense. The opposite is true for Florida, the burden back on their offense now. They had 121 yards in their first two drives of offense. Since then, on 5 offensive drives, only 94 yards. So the Georgia defense has settled down. They got the turnover right before the half, and now momentum changing in this football game.
Well, this time the ball stays on the tee, and Katu kicks it fairly short. He's kicking into the wind, and that one was held up, grabbed at the 12, and back out to the 31-yard line. I must tell you, Todd, my mind flashed back to 1982 when I saw that play. I did a Wisconsin-Illinois play, a game. The head coach was Dave McLean, the late Dave McLean. They ran what they call the oh my play. I'm cleaning this up. Where the quarterback, Randy Wright, turns his back and deliberately throws the ball on a one-hopper out to Al Toon, where the offensive line turns around and goes, oh my. They relax. Al Toon threw a touchdown pass of 55 yards. Wow. And when I saw Tereshinski go down, my mind flashed back 23 years. Here's the pass to Jamel Cornelius.
Each pass completed to number six.
84,000 in a state of disbelief, 14-10. And Dallas Baker back on the field now, number 81. Here's Leak, pulls it back. Tim Jackson, see ya. Tim Jennings.
Oh, my. Tim Jennings may be the littlest guy out there at 5'8", 178. But when you catch a guy unaware and you're coming full speed and he hasn't even turned his head yet, you can hit like this. Tim Jennings all over this play. The quick throw, and as soon as Jackson turned around, Jennings just planted him backwards.
Willie Martinez, defensive coordinator, replaced Brian Van Gorder on the Georgia staff. And as they went to the sideline, Chris Leake, fake. Eric Wilbur got the first plus a bunch to the 41.
We saw Mark Richt with the call on the throwback to the quarterback. Urban Meyer says, take that. Designed fake punt all the way, and they caught Georgia flat-footed. Eric Wilbur, you see, you got the big guys back here as your personal protectors. Only one guy on this side. That's where they ran the fake, but all three personal protectors went that way. Two linemen and Billy Latsko, the fullback. A much-needed play by the Florida special teams.
This is the second time we've seen them with a fake punt. Earl Everett picked up one earlier this year. Out of the punt formation, that was a gain of 20, a first down at the 40. Here's Leak. Fires it to the 37-yard line, Tate Casey.
This is getting fun.
Yes,
this is getting fun.
Eric Wilbur, first rush of his career. And it's second and five.
You know, and really, the game changes so quickly. It was actually his poor punt that set up Georgia's touchdown drive. He shanked that punt, and now he comes back the next time he gets out there. He fakes it and makes a big play.
Second and five. Here's the option and the pitch and a bobble.
First time they've run the option all day, and it blew up. I mean, poorly executed. And part of it is the Georgia defense is starting to toughen up against that inside run. So this time they fake inside to Manson. And Chris Leake, because see, Quentin Moses closed down so fast, he has to pull that out. But then he made a bad pitch. And here we are at the very end of the third quarter. That's the first time in the game that he's had to try to pitch the football like that.
We've reached the end of three. At Alltel Stadium, 14-10, Florida leads. We'll return to Jacksonville, Florida right after this word from your local station.
Stand up fire. They may or may not blitz. They won't. Buck back third down on the eight. In trouble. Got a block behind him. Then a throw and a run. Complete to the 25. To the 30. Lindsey's got 35, 40. Lindsey's got 45, 50. 45, 40. Run, Lindsey. 25, 20, 50, 10, 5. Lindsey stop. Lindsey stop.
This is the 25th anniversary of what Vince Dooley called the most important play in Georgia football history. Larry Munson was 58 years old when he made that call. Larry Munson this afternoon is calling his 40th Georgia-Florida game.
Florida 5 of 10, but they've only converted one of their last six. A big one right here for Chris Lee.
Mark Manson comes out wide left. Here's
blitz.
Leak.
First time they blitzed.
Empty backfield.
And they got him. Tony Taylor, the first time that they've blitzed. And you're right, it came off the empty backfield. And Tony Taylor came right up the gut unblocked.
Flag on the far side.
Here's Tony Taylor, number 43. He's going to come inside. You see Ray Gant absorb the block of Mike DeGore, and that left Taylor free to come right to the quarterback.
And then Quentin Moses got there. Looks like we've got a sideline warning again. This one on the Georgia bench,
Quentin Moses there, Tony Taylor, a very timely blitz by the Georgia defense, and now one of their last seven third downs, Florida has only converted.
Eric Wilbur, who ran it out of punt formation last time out, and previous to that had a 29-yard punt. And Wilbur is kicking into the wind now. And it's a nice kick. Fair catch called at the 7-yard line by Thomas Flowers. A 40-yard punt. Very effective.
Yeah. Now we've seen Florida flip the field position. Georgia did it early in this half, and now Florida puts their defense in great position. Georgia, a long field to work with. Well, Joe Tereshinski is already going to be remembered for his participation in this game one way or another. If he leads this comeback to a Georgia victory, he'll be legendary.
Immediate elevation. Here's the play fake. Tereshinski and a mix-up on the play. It's incomplete as Leonard Pope tried to shake loose of Burnell Brown and couldn't quite get the Jarvis Herring.
Leonard Pope, two catches in the ball game, both in the first half. Martrez Milner, their other weapon at tight end, no catches. He's coming out of the game now, being replaced by Muhammad Massaqua, who has had a pretty good ball game catching the ball from Joe Tereshinski. But they've got to hit a couple plays in the passing game to go along with what they do running it.
They'll keep it on the ground and not get anything. Brandon Seiler, number 40, made sure of that as he cold cocked Danny Ware.
But credit Stephen Harris, the defensive tackle. He's the guy who got penetration, number 93, and forced Danny Ware to bounce it back inside. And that's where Seiler wrapped him up.
Mark Richt's team 18-2 in opponent stadiums, but only 5-5 in neutral sites. And this is a neutral site. It's third down, 11. Play action, blitz coming, deep pass caught. Out to the 40, first down.
What
clock
a big
stops
throw.
While they get move the chains.
What a big throw. I formation, they go play action on third down. That helps with pass protection. It keeps normal personnel on the field. It's a zone defense for Florida. Normally they play man. This time they chose to play zone, and McClendon found the hole behind the linebackers for the first down.
Charlie Strong, defensive coordinator, co-coordinator. First down after the 21-yard gain. The clock starts again. It's 2 minutes to go. Here's Tereshinski. Pumps once, drills it, man open, hits him in the helmet. Hit him right in the helmet, McClendon.
Boy, they had that one too. Good pass protection. Florida brought a couple linebackers in this play. So man-to-man coverage, and McClendon was wide open. And the ball just doinked right off his face mask.
Second down and 10.
The only good thing about that is the clock stopped. They still have two timeouts as well.
Thomas Brown is in the ballgame now. Here's Tereshinski. Ryan Schnetzer is the center. Blitz, Tereshinski across the middle, knocked down at the line of scrimmage. Might have been Mincy, might have been Thomas. See who got his hand up. Third and 10.
Florida showing pressure, and then they dropped out. Four-man rush, and Jeremy Mincy got his hands up. Nick Jones was blocking on him, but not able to get the hands down. And another big third down and long for Georgia. The last time they played zone, and he found a hole. Will they come after him on this third down play?
Two wide left, one wide right. Quarterback, keeper again. And Tereshinski's going to be facing a fourth and 12.
Jarvis Moss, what a play. And the clock is rolling. I think Georgia has to call a timeout here to set up what they want exactly on the fourth down play. They certainly didn't expect to lose yardage. This is two down territory, so I'm sure they're thinking even if we get six or seven, we've got a manageable fourth down. They lost yardage because of the great play by Jarvis Moss.
Florida needs a victory in this game, plus help from somebody else, in order to remain in contention for the spot in Atlanta. They lead by four. 69 seconds to go. Georgia burned a timeout. They've got one left, but more significantly, they have a fourth down, 11. They are undefeated in SEC play thus far, 5-0. Should they win today, they would clinch a spot in the championship game in Atlanta. If Florida hangs on and wins this, they then must win out and hope that somebody else beats Georgia to get that spot. Now then, fourth and 11.
Well, I think you've got to protect Joe Tereshinski, first of all. You've got to make sure you have good, solid protection. And then you've got to call a play that can convert versus man or zone, because you don't know what Florida's going to play on this fourth down play. I formation, tight end in the game, see what Florida plays.
Here's the play fake and the blitz. Tereshinski throws it up, incomplete. He heaved the ball as he was going down, and it was number 57, Jeremy Mincy.
Fourth and 11, no threat of a run, so the Florida front can really come after the quarterback. It's just a four-man rush. Ray McDonald was the guy who got there first. He forced him up in the pocket, and Jeremy Mincy finished him off. Ray McDonald, the first game healthy back from the knee surgery, makes the play, and Mincy gets the sack.
Wow. And the reaction from the Gators. Brian Crum. Joe Tereshinski the third. Not to be.
He didn't have a chance on that play. Ray McDonald was in the backfield quickly.
Georgia can stop it one more time. Here's the handoff. Deshaun Wynn. And he picks up a half a yard. Will Thompson. Well, this is a Florida team. There's Brandon Cattu, 1 for 3 today. He missed from 39. He doinked one from 52. Deshaun Wynn coming to the sideline, and Georgia uses its final timeout. Well, Florida now through the heavy part of their schedule. Here's what Georgia has remaining. They have an off week. Then they are at home against Auburn, at home against Kentucky, and finish off at Georgia Tech. One of those teams must defeat the Bulldogs, and all of a sudden Florida's become huge Auburn fans. And here is Chris Leak, finally takes a knee and then is pounced upon. Trey Battle with the tackle. And for Urban Meyer's team, they lose to LSU 21-17 week before last. Apparently going to win this. Then they are at home next week against Vanderbilt at South Carolina. It'll be a ball coach against a ball coach. And Florida State, a game that we will televise.
Tell you, this was a gut check win for Florida. It really was. And they did it by running the football. It was their running game that took pressure off Chris Leak more than anything else and allowed them to win the football game today.
Florida's going to win it for the 14th time in the last 16 years. And the player of the game, season high, 108 yards, 19 carries, an average of just under 6 per, career high, both carries and yards. Number 21 had a costly bobble at the end of the first half that, had they held on to the ball going in, would have given them a 21-3 lead. But for Joe Tereshinski the third, and the Georgia Bulldogs, the undefeated season comes to a close. Mark Richt, Urban Meyer. The exchange of pleasantries at midfield. Tim, the final. Florida got all 14 in the first quarter, hung on to win it by 4. Chris Leak, Muhammad Basqua, teammates at Independence High School in Charlotte, North Carolina. Let's go down to Tracy, who's with Urban Meyer.
Thanks a lot, Coach. After a tough, emotional last few weeks, how big of a win is this for your team?
This is a huge win. You know, it wasn't pretty, but I'll tell you what, in the SEC Conference, there's some great defenses, and Florida Gators are one of those great defenses. They hunt in there, and I'm awful proud of our team.
How How about the poise and the performance of this guy over here, Chris Lee?
Yeah, we did a lot of good things for him, and I'll tell you what, he played his heart out. Chris Lee's a great football player.
Chris, how did you get it done today?
We just came out, we stuck together as a team, and we went out, just played with a passion. And, the guys in the locker room just did an awesome job. Defense, offense, special teams.
Thanks a lot. Congratulations. You're still in the hunt for the SEC championship. Back to you guys.
Joe Tereshinski catches a touchdown pass, but it winds up a 14-10 win for the Florida Gators. Tim Brando will be along shortly for Todd Blackledge and Tracy Wolfson and all of our traveling crew of the SEC on CBS. Vern Lundquist, see you next week.